Now, my first guest is fighting this war right alongside the Ukrainian people. That's despite being a former member of the Russian parliament. But Ilya Ponomarev was the only Russian politician to vote against the annexation of Crimea back in 2014. And so he is in Kiev and he's joining me now. Welcome back to the program. We talked to you all those years back when you voted against Putin's invasion back in 2014. Tell me what you're doing right now. How did you manage to join the Ukrainian forces?
Oh, you remember that time you asked me, why did I do what I have done? And I said that it means war between Russia and Ukraine. And as you see now, unfortunately, I was right. And at that time, I said that if this war would start, I would fight for peace, and that's what I am doing.
That is extraordinary. So you believed all those years ago that Crimea and those parts of the Donbass region were not the end for Putin, that he would go further.
Absolutely. I didn't believe that he would start the war this February. I would be very frank. I many times repeatedly said that he would first take over Belarus and only then would go into Ukraine. But he has made this suicidal step. That's very irrational step for himself, probably because he was very ill-informed about the real mood of Ukrainian people. And now we see what we see, thousands and thousands of deaths, among Ukrainian civilian and Russian soldiers.
Can you tell me, Ilya, what you see when you are anywhere near the battlefront in terms of the casualties? Because obviously all sides are giving different numbers. And it's interesting to know what's happening to the Russians, if you're able to see that. Can you? Do you have any good information, at least from your area where you're fighting, on what the kind of casualties on the opposite side are?
Well, my observation is that each Ukrainian soldier takes at least 4 lives of Russian soldiers. That's more or less the ratio. But unfortunately, the same number of civilians die at the same time. So as many Russians are dying, as many Ukrainian civilians. That is horrible. And that's very much because of the situation in the Ukrainian skies, because there is no fly zone, and that what kills people every day.
And Ilya, we are obviously in Kiev, and there's all sorts of different descriptions about what this battlefield, this urban battlefield, looks like. You know, is it stalled? Are we in a state of a stalemate around the capital? Do you believe that the Russians still want to encircle the capital? Or what can you see again from your analysis?
I think that they will try to encircle the capital. Right now, they have been pushed back in the western and northwestern direction. They're pretty much stopped on the eastern and northeastern direction. I think that despite being pushed back in the west, they would most likely try to advance to the south and to encircle Kyiv on the right bank of Dnipro River. But I think that very unlikely that they would succeed. They are trying to provoke a humanitarian catastrophe in Kyiv to the same magnitude like they were doing in Mariupol. But in Mariupol, they physically exterminated the city because the city is smaller and very much linked to the sea. Kyiv is a very large city. So it's very hard to bomb and to shell it all together, but it's possible to cut off the food supplies, to poison the water, to cut off electricity and natural gas, the heating of the city. And I am very much afraid that that is the actual objective of Russian troops at this very moment.
So what do you make of the Russian general from the Ministry of Defense, you know, in Moscow, Sergei Rudskoy, who basically over the weekend laid out what looked like a change of plans? Do you see it as a change of plans, or do you take him at face value that we've done what we intended to do? We have weakened and, you know, more demilitarized the enemy, i.e. the Ukrainians, and now we're really going to just concentrate on what we really want, which is all of the Donbass region.
Well, obviously, they're losing the war. That's for sure. And there is no way how the war can be won by Russia. So it's only a question of where they can settle. And their only hope is to try to save face by saying that they didn't want to capture Kyiv, for example, which is not true. That was their initial plan, and we know this for sure. That they didn't plan to capture Odessa or Kharkiv, which is not true. But that they wanted just to extend the territory of so-called people republics in the east of Ukraine, in Donbass. And here very much is dependent, we are very much dependent on the position of international community. If Ukraine would be synchronously pushed into the ceasefire both by Kremlin and by Washington, they may try to create a new set of so-called Minsk agreements and to capture the territory and to keep this territory for an indefinite period of time. But the spirit in the Ukrainians right now is that we need to prevail, we need to win this war, and that we have all the capabilities to win this war. It's now a matter of price, and this price is very much dependent on you guys, whether you would help us to eliminate the jet fighters, the bombers, and the missiles in the skies, or we will do it ourselves.
Ilya, what about? I mean, it is odd that a Russian, and not just a Russian parliamentary member, would come over here in the. I mean, I know you've been living here for a while, but how did you get the Ukrainian military to accept you in their ranks? And are there any other Russians that you know of anywhere around where you are fighting as well, for this side, Ukraine?
Not where I am, but in general, there are numerous Russians in Ukraine fighting. There were numerous Russians who were coming to join Ukrainian military and volunteer groups back in 2014. I believe there are several thousand of them. There is one regiment which I know next to Kyiv, which is fighting on the Ukrainian side against the invaders. But the question is very simple. We think that the key to freedom in Russia right now is in Ukraine. If we are victorious here, if we will defeat Putin here, we will win Russia. That's very much like German anti-fascists were doing back in World War II. You know that the Chancellor Willy Brandt, for example, the leader of German Social Democrats, he was fighting within the Allied armies in Norway against German fascists. And that's not because he was anti-German, and I am not anti-Russian. I am pro-Russian, but I am anti-Putin, and we will kill the bastard.
Well, you have written recently that you don't think he'll be, quote unquote, on this planet in another year. But it is fascinating what you say, because you're fighting for your own country, to liberate your own country via Ukraine. That's obviously the one thing that Putin really fears. One of the reasons many Russians and other analysts say that he just doesn't want Ukraine to be free and democratic and independent is because then ordinary Russians will start asking why it's not okay for them also to be free and democratic. Do you get that sense? Is that where we are in your country, in Russia?
I think so. Ukraine is very much the Achilles tendon for Mr. Putin. And his propaganda, all the way down, he was portraying Ukraine as a failed state, because he was saying, you see, Ukrainians have made their revolution and they are failing. And you shouldn't do the revolution here in Russia, because you will fail as Ukrainians did. But we are not failing. We are developing here. The country is very actively moving forward. Without that war, will be moving forward way more rapidly than it was before. Ukraine has all the rights to change their leadership. We had the previous president, now we have a new president, because we wanted to change, we wanted new set of reforms, we wanted new direction of the development, and we have done this. If you would travel across the country, you would see how well the infrastructure in Ukraine has developed during the 2 years of President Zelensky, for example. And now these Russian soldiers, which are coming with their tanks into the streets of Ukrainian villages, they're saying, wow, guys, you have asphalt here. We don't have that much in Russia. You live well.